is efficient scalable constant around MPC via Garbled secrets by Anil Ben Efflin, Yun Huang Mindel, Aaron Olin. Anil will give us a talk.
Thank you. My name is Anirban Efrai, and I'll talk about efficient scalable constant bound multi-party computation via Garbled circuits. This is a joint work with Yehuda Lindel and Elan Owen. Okay, so my talk plan is to first give a little bit of motivation. Then I'll go over the basics of Garbled circuits, Yaw's protocol, and even Kali-Raboid protocol. After that, I'll talk about kilomorphic semi-random functions and show how they are used in a new method for multi-party garbling. And I'll conclude with some experimental results and then open question. Okay, so what is secure multi-party computation? Well, basically the idea is that a set of parties wants to compute a function of their inputs without revealing only the output. However, some of the parties might be corrupt. For example, you can think of an auction where each bidder is supposed to give only one bid, and the auctioneer wants to sell an artifact to the highest bid. So there are some desirable properties that we might want. For example, we want correctness. We want the highest bidder to receive the artifact. We want privacy. They don't want to reveal their bids unless maybe they are the winning bid. We want independence of inputs. We don't want the bidders to place their bids according to the bids of others. We want fairness. What this means in secure computation is basically we don't want the corrupt parties to receive the output first and then maybe abort the protocol. We might also want guaranteed output delivery, and of course, we want everything to be efficient. So in this work, we focus on the efficiency part of the protocol. Okay, so most multi-party computation protocols basically first encode the function as a Boolean or a symmetric circuit, and then compute input and secure computation this as a circuit. Okay, so if the inputs are known, revealed, this is fairly simple. But in secure computation, we of course don't want to reveal the inputs, so the parties somehow have to mask their inputs. And then at each gate, using these mask inputs of the gate, compute mask outputs of the gate and go forward in the circuit until only the outputs of the circuit are revealed. So basically the question is how to mask these inputs and how to compute at each gate the mask output using the mask inputs. And there are two approaches to this. The first approach is the garbled circuit approach, such as in Yao and the Beaver-McCauley-Raboy protocols, in which basically the entire circuit is garbled or encrypted in parallel and sent. So this has a constant number of rounds of communication, but they're fairly big rounds. And the second approach, which is the secret sharing approach, such as in GMW, BGW, and speed, the parties secret share their inputs, and then at each layer of the circuit, they compute, they interact in order to compute shares of the next layer. Okay, so this doesn't have a constant number of rounds, but it does have lower bandwidth. Okay, so there are somewhat incomparable approaches, and in this work we focus on the garbled circuit approach. So there are two main types of adversarial behavior, how we model the corrupt behavior. So there's the semi-honest behavior, in which the adversary follows the protocol, but might try to learn some private information. And there's the more realistic model, which is the malicious model, which the adversary can deviate from the protocol arbitrarily. So this model is more realistic. Malicious model is more realistic and it's harder to achieve, but it's also sometimes interesting to focus on the semi-honest model as we do here. One reason to do so is, and it's a two-step method, is first to generate, to show that we can improve in the semi-honest model, and then maybe as a second step, improve in the malicious model, and this has been a good strategy in the past that I'll show in the next slide. Okay, so some implementations of multi-party garbled circuits, they're based on the Beaver-McCauley-Raboy protocol. So the first implementation, which is actually the first secure multi-party implementation, just less than a decade ago, was Fairplay IP. Last year we did an optimized implementation that implements the FreeXOR by Kolesnikov and Schneider, which was secure against N-1 parties. And the malicious model, there was a work by Lindel et al. That combined BMR and speeds, but this was a little bit slower. But the state of the art shows actually that there's almost no overhead from going from semi-honest to malicious. say, state of the art, basically the work which you saw yesterday by Khazai et al, which extended our work, and work by Wing et al. Okay, so basically, going from they showed that going from semi-honest to malicious gives almost no overhead. Okay, so BMR is great, and it has a lot of advantages. It's constant ground, store gates are free. We can use AES for the encryption, so that's very fast. It can be secure up to N-1 parties. So it's and it's extremely fast for a small to medium number of parties. But there is one caveat. Each party has to encrypt the keys of all the parties. Okay, to illustrate this, let's first go over YAO. Basically, the output key is somehow encrypted using the input keys. Okay, and this would be the garbled gate. Just static, think about it. So when we go to the multi-party case into BMR, instead of one key, basically each party is going to have a key, so we're going to have n keys. And when we want to encrypt it, each party is going to encrypt the keys of all the parties. So this shows that there is some quadratic blow-up. Okay, and the small gate becomes big fairly quickly when the number of parties increases. Okay, and you might think that maybe we can distribute the computation, but when we think about it in the online phase, the evaluating parties actually perform all the computation locally. Okay, so that basically means that the online time grows quadratically the number of parties, and so for a very large number of parties, BMR protocol is going to be impractical. Okay, this is actually a graph from the previous work. It just shows that when the number of parties increases, the running time does indeed grow quadratically. Okay, the online running time does indeed grow quadratically. Okay, so our results, we show a new way to extend YAO to the multi-party setting based on key homomorphic pseudo-random functions. The keys are summed instead of being concatenated. I'll explain this later. What this means is that the key length does not grow, and so the online computation does not grow with the number of parties. Okay, so this was suggested before, but it wasn't based on key homomorphic PRFs, and the problem with that is that you have to compute in the offline phase the entire encryption. Okay, that's impractical. Here, because we're using key homomorphic PRFs, the offline is only going to be computing a very simple arithmetic circuit in multi-party computation. And we did two instantiations, one based on DDH, the other based on ring and WE. We implemented, we did some optimizations, and we ran experimentation, and showed that it does outperform highly optimized BMR for a large enough number of parties. Okay, so now that you have some motivation, let's go over the basics of garbage circuits. Okay, so I'll start with YAO's protocol. We have two parties. One is the garbler, one is the evaluator. So the garbler is going to somehow encrypt, or garble or encrypt, all the gates in parallel. So all we need to understand is how to encrypt a single gate. Okay, so we have a gate, for example, an AND gate, and it has a truth table. And now the garbler picks for each wire of the circuit two keys, one corresponding to the zero value and one corresponding to the one value. And the garbler is going to encrypt the keys of the output wire using the keys of the input wires according to the truth table. Okay, so for example, the output key zero will be encrypted under the pair of keys 00, 01, 10, and the output key one will be encrypted under the pair of keys 11. Okay, now the evaluator at the online phase, if he receives the keys corresponding to 1 and 0, he can decrypt and receive the key corresponding to 0. Of course, as I said it here, this is completely insecure because the evaluator should not know that the values on the wire should not know that receive the keys 1 and 0 corresponding to the value on the wire 1 and 0. So what is done is called quantum permute. The key that the evaluator sees in the online phase doesn't correspond to the real value, but it corresponds to some external value which is independent of the real value. Okay. And when we go from the two-party setting to the multi-party setting, the main difference is the parties actually have to perform the garbling collaboratively in some MPC subprotocol. Okay, this is to protect that the garblers won't collude with an evaluator and we lose security. So the multi-party computation. Via garbling is basically in two phases, the offline phase in which the parties use an MPC subprotocol to compute the garbled circuit, and then in the online phase, the parties exchange the garbled inputs and corresponding keys, and each party, or an evaluating party, locally computes the outputs of the circuit. Okay, so the previous solution is the BMR Garbled circuit. The idea, of course, is the encryption developed by all the parties, each with its own key. And the keys are somewhat concatenated. Okay, this was how it was explained in the original BMR work. And, so, and now each party chooses two random keys instead of just one Garbled party. And for each gate in each row, each party encrypts the keys of all the parties. Okay, so we have a total number of encryptions is O of n squared per gate. Okay, because each party is encrypting the keys of each other party. When we go to the evaluation, okay, we have first the two communication nodes to exchange the garbled keys. And then each party has to do, or each evaluating party has to do all the decryptions by itself. So basically it has to do O of n squared decryptions per gate. Okay, so this shows the quadratic complexity. So now that we understand the problem, let's see how we propose to solve it. So what are key homomorphic pseudorandom functions? Well, basically it's a pseudorandom function which has in which the domain of the input keys and the domain of the output of the functions have group structures which have this nice homomorphic property. Fk1 of x times fk2 of x is equal to fk1 plus k2 of x. Okay, so let's see an example. The first key homomorphic pseudorandom function was based on PBH and a random oracle by Naor, Pinkas, and Rangel. So the function is fairly simple. Fk of x equals to x to the power of k. This is not a pseudorandom function, it's just a weak pseudorandom function. It's indistinguishable if we take random inputs. And we see that it has this nice homomorphic property, which fk1 of x times fk2 of x is equal to fk1 plus k2 of x. And they use a random oracle to go from a weak PRF to a weak. Okay, and Bonetal and Banerjee and Reichert introduced key homomorphic pseudorandom functions also without a random oracle based on LWE and ring LWE. So the new method for multi-party garbling, the idea is to sum the keys instead of concatenating them. And so this means that we're only going to have a single decryption at each gate, and the key length is not going to grow, and it results in some sort of Galois-like garbled circuit. Okay, so the idea, as I said, was that it's not new. It was suggested in the past, but the difference was it wasn't based on key homomorphic PRFs, so there was a problem. We need to compute the entire encryption in multi-party computation. This would mean a very huge offline computation, and it's not really practical. So of course, the solution is to use key homomorphic PRFs for the encryption. Now, the PRFs themselves are locally computed by the parties. Okay, each party computes its own PRF, and all the parties need to do in order to compute the garbled circuit is compute the homomorphic property in MPC. Okay. So this big circuit that we had, so it shrinks, and we get this small but circuit in which the sum of the output keys are encrypted using the sum of the input keys of the parties. Okay, this is the sum. Now when we decrypt, the parties are going to receive the sum of the output keys, but they don't actually need to know the individual keys because they're going to use the sum of the output keys in order to decrypt the next gate. And this is the overview of the idea. Okay, so some experimental results. The numerical experimentation. We increased the number of parties up to 500. Notice this is only online computation time, so this is run locally on one machine without the communication. The circuit was generated locally. And this is just the online computation time. So the blue line, of course, is the BMR, which grows quadratically in the running time. And the dashed lines are the dashed lines are based on PBH. Okay, so the first one was VVM optimized, and the second one is with optimization, so that we can pre-compute some of the exponents from standard. Then these are based on discrete log with short exponent. What this means is that the keys are shorter. Okay, so but this is not known to be if the keys are sufficiently long, for example, 256 bits, this is not going to have more weaknesses. Okay, but if we have go to 160 bits, then this only gives us, for example, 80 bits of security because there are no square attacks. Okay, so here we have, for example, the cutoff point is around 75 parties. But as I said, this gives us only about 80 bits of security, and also it's a prime, which is only 124 bits long, so it's not very secure, I guess. The ring LWE version beats all these, so let's see, when we want to increase security, we probably use the key size of base 256, so we get 128 bits of security. And then the question is which kind of size of prime we want, so I think today is suggested 2048, approximately 128 bits. And so here the cutoff point is approximately 175. And so an open question. The main problem is that the non-instantiations, what I showed, they're not in characteristic 2. Okay. These chemical fields that I showed are not in characteristic 2. This has a lot of problems. First of all, there's no fluid store. There are a lot more offline rounds. And it's hard to compute with this transfer. And overall, it's just much less efficient. So I think, for me, the most interesting open question is defining instantiations. And what I mean by instantiations is not only just kilomorphic PRFs, but also kilomorphic PRFs that can actually be used in our protocol. Okay, that we're deficient. Okay, so maybe DDH over elliptic curves, in which we know there are kilomorphic PRFs, or maybe ring LPN, which I don't know if it can work, but it could be super fast if it does. Or maybe some other suggestion. Thank you very much. Are there any questions?
Question? We have a lot of time for questions. Comments? Do you want another one?
No.
Okay. I noticed that you mentioned the protocol by CAT is different from your protocol. You can just give some comments.
I actually asked, I don't know myself, I know that it's different. The main, I asked yesterday, and I understood that the main difference is that it's somewhat asymmetric. It's somewhat asymmetric, so one party does the evaluation, so only the other party do the garbling. And they basically also, because of that, they don't have the key, so they also have to generate its external value and put it in. So it's slightly different, but as I understand it, it's not much different. I don't really know.
Okay, thank you. More questions? Okay, there is no questions. Let's thank the panel again.